Hello and good morning everyone, and welcome to the first of many panels for this year's TPK Con. Pressure's on to make a great first impression and set the tone, but I've got a fantastic crew here with me to help shoulder that responsibility. Even if it meant waking up early to do it, I'm sorry. From the top, I am Meg Mysteria, and I will be asking these folks some questions about finding your role-playing niche. Speaking of them, let's go around the table and introduce ourselves, starting up that top left.
Hi, my name is Proper Nerdy. I'm a staff member, role-player, and game designer, and a bunch of little things at this point. I have lots of pretty pictures of videos, including some of the stuff you see around you. And, we'll get into what our niches are, because I don't know what mine is, but I don't have quite an idea what it is. I think the lady is Sarah.
Hi, I am Osarix Franco. I say words and do things on the internet sometimes. Twitch and Twitter are places you can find me. I play in a variety of TTRPGs across this community as well as over at Nat20. Both as a player, I do GM once a month and have a talk show where we talk about GMing and all the cool things that go with it. And I realized this morning as I was making my coffee that maybe that's a part of my niche, is just talking about doing the thing.
You don't do the thing. You just talk about it a lot.
Yeah, we just talk about it.
Discuss it secondhand. Oh, I guess that leaves it. That's me. I'm a third of the way through my coffee, so I'm still tired. But my name is Mads. You can find me, JK Madigan, on Twitch and Twitter and all of those things. I primarily host the Top Shelf for TPK, but I'm also a game designer and player and other things. Not quite as diversified as Proper yet, because he does all the cool art stuff, but I'm getting there. Eventually I'll catch up. I know what my niche is, but I don't do any kind of prep work before anything, so we'll see what happens. This will be good.
I think that's your niche, right? You don't prep?
Oh, I don't know if that's good or bad.
I'm Fazul. You might recognize me from, I'm a GM here at TPK, and I'm running the Atrium of Aquarius, the Altered Carbon campaign. I'm also a game designer, writer. My brands would be One Shot RPG, Mini Quests, and Dread Quests and Survive RPG. So it's a pleasure to be here. Thanks, Meg, because it's funny, I was just saying beforehand, I didn't really think about niches until this came up. So it's been a great kind of reflective exercise as well. So this will be fun.
Oh yeah, between last year and this year, I really love talking about doing reflections and stuff like that and delving into that sort of thing. So with that, I guess we'll go ahead and get right into it. Chat, of course, feel free to ask any questions you might have or yell at us to slow down if there's something you want us to expand on. We love getting feedback and want you guys to be involved with this discussion along with us. So with that, we talked a little bit about it, but I guess my first question for you all is, how would you define having a niche when it comes to roleplay?
Oof. This question wasn't assigned ahead of time.
It was not. I don't assign
things. She's going off script. She's going off script.
I'm not going off script. They're all in the notes on the doc. You guys had plenty of time.
It's true. I'll just chime in just really quickly there. I feel like when I was invited to like the panel and like thinking about niche, like the thing I thought about was kind of the genre of game that I play. And then like through watching you guys, I feel like I expanded my understanding of like what that could possibly mean. But I mean, like, understanding like the themes and elements that I like to explore in games. I'm a high fantasy homie, you know, give me that hero's journey realness. I like the tropes of the characters and all the things. But also like a heavy emphasis on character development and really the narrative aspect over anything else. Like, I feel like that's really where I thrive in TTRPGs. Like, you want somebody to like care about like mechanics or whatever. I am not your dude. You want someone to come and like help you tell a story? I'm fucking there. Let's go.
I think it becomes at a certain point, Niche is all about what Sarah said at the end there of like, what are elements of storytelling are important to you? Because I would be willing to play in almost any TTRPG, whatever setting, whatever fantasy, modern, cyberpunk, whatever. Like I'm fascinated by any of them, but I think the kind of atmosphere you want, or the kind of like player to player or like GM to player like connections, are what defines my niche. Because they're like, I love everyone on TPK. There are certain tables I just like don't want to play at right now because of the like the setup between GMs or between players just doesn't feel right. And so I think that kind of, and there's a better word to say what I'm saying, it is early in the morning, but the kind of like dynamics of a table are kind of where I think the niche falls. And thankfully for TPK, a lot of us kind of follow the same kind of like very narrative focus, like fuck the rules mentality. But you know, there's still slight differences in that I really try. Like I find myself enjoying games more if the dynamics are right. Someone else talk before I keep rambling.
I think, I don't know. I see my niche or niches in general as two different things, I guess. It's part of it is what you play, and I guess part of it is how you play, and both of you have touched on that simultaneously, which I think each person kind of falls into one of each. But you've got high fantasy, you've got I don't give a damn, I'll play anything. You're more focused on the how the play functions, but I think there is definitely preferences in both. And I found myself kind of falling into, I really love heists. Any like genre doesn't matter, but if it's a heist, I'm in. And I really love horror elements. And I think horror elements for me specifically and heists all kind of tie into the same when it comes to how you play. Narrative becomes even more important when failure is involved. I adore failure specifically in tabletop games, and whether that be in a horror game where you're narrowly making it out of something, or the stress is starting to pile and you have to deal with these things, or in a heist game where everything is perfectly planned and then something slips and now all of a sudden everybody's scrambling for, you know, the off the cuff, how do we make it out of this with the cash or whatever it may be. I really have this personal focus on very much enjoying games that allow for progressive failures being part of that narrative, whether that's dice or narrated.
I know Fazul hasn't gotten to talk, but I do want to chime in on that, because I've realized as a GM, I'm really bad at failures, but as a player, I thoroughly enjoy failures. And so like in Monster of the Week, I'm like, yeah, give me that failure. Sure, why not? And as a GM, I'm like, oh, what do I do though?
Well, you don't plan anything, then you never know what to do.
Yeah, it's I agree with you, Proper. Failures are definitely challenging as a GM. It's funny, I have a slightly different, it's similar, but a slightly different take on niches. Niches are, what do you do differently than any other player or GM? So if you're at a table with six people, what is different about maybe your approach? Or even as a writer, like JK, you just released A Sailor's Grave, which is available on itch, and that is as soon as you release it, I went, okay, that's a niche, because nobody else is doing it, right? It's something which is, you're trying to set yourself apart. You could have come out with yet another fantasy game, but that would just blend into the background with D&D and countless others. So for me, like, I think about what makes things unique. And for one, I've tried to, I guess one of my, probably my biggest niche, I think, is twists. So I try to stand out from other GMs by being the M. Night Shyamalan behind the screen, so to speak.
Setting a high bar for yourself.
I'm not saying I am him. I'm just saying I aspire to be the GM where someone hears that, oh, he's GMing this adventure. They know, oh, there's going to be a twist and are looking for it, right? So as mm-hmm. as an example.
Yeah. I love that. And like tagging in, because like it's funny, like Chrissy's kind of popping off in chat listing some of the different things. Like, and if I think about it from your frame of reference of what makes you different, I feel like as both a player and a GM, for me, it is notes. It is the obsessive like documentation of like what it is that I want to do. And like,
but I'll tell
playing
you,
Sarah, off of those.
Having GM'd to you quite a few times now, you know, you have an incredible ability to just become the character and your details. Like if I asked you, what's your character doing right now? Your level of detail on describing what the character's wearing, even like it's funny, JK, I remember that, what was it? Blood and Lies or Iron and Lies.
Iron and Lies. That was
like
so that, fun.
When you were describing your character, I still remember your description saying the stickiness on the bottom of your sneakers, right? From working in the mm-hmm. cafe, I'm going, most players probably wouldn't. And it's not a knock, Dato. I wouldn't. Like if I was a player, I wouldn't think to mention that. But it's those subtle details that really kind of make, like vividly create that image in my mind, right? So, yeah, so it's interesting. It is, but.
Okay, so then. We're kind of broaching into that. I'm going to go ahead and just add my little take on it because I guess it'd be a little bit odd if the host didn't speak a bit at their own panel. But my own definition, it's a little bit of everything that's been kind of mentioned, I guess. It's attributes that you kind of excel at and gravitate towards. That includes genres and archetypes, things that you personally can bring to the table. And you guys have all kind of went ahead and talked about your stuff and knocked out the next question in this list here. But, as far as kind of what I think my own niche is that I tend to go more towards, either... I'm sorry, I lost my train of thought.
All good, dude.
I personally, and this is where Proper and I are going to have an argument, I like really high stress systems. yeah, he's shaking his head. I like high stress systems. I like Chrissy mentioned in chat, the dramatic moments. I love those things because I like the kind of the grittiness of it, I guess. So with that, I tend to gravitate more towards like the horror things along with JK and you guys all know my obsession. So
who said that? We didn't say that. What?
But chat might not know. Obsession.
well, you see, according to the literal wall behind me,
I am... face hugger attached to your chair,
the
yeah.
The face hugger, whatever. My blankets even got Xenomorphs on it.
I think it's interesting.
Next niche is just Alien. That's all it is.
Just Alien. Alien and Resident Evil. That's all you get from me.
But I appreciate that because it's like there's an intensity there, right? Like it's that kind of hold your breath. And what I love here, like as we kind of talk through this, like Proper and I have talked about this a whole bunch. Proper and I are very similar in our niches, but there are things that make us very different. Like in like how we approach things, like, and it's funny too, like I feel like you and Fazul have kind of the same like kind of vibe with like twists or dramatic moments, but they're just flavored very uniquely to Fazul and to Meg, like that they are inherently different even though they're like that adjacent kind of vibe.
Yeah, everybody's got their own way of portraying their story, and I really feel like it's leans more into, I guess, what your focus comes in is what things you're passionate about.
I was just gonna say, you mentioned or you made the joke about like it's only Alien or it's only Resident Evil, and Sarah jumped on that saying, you know, yeah, let's do it, like stick with that, enjoy the thing that you're really really passionate about. And I played Alien for the first time, and the guy running it was probably as intensely steeped in Alien lore as you are, which is hard to even but it was,
there's not that much content to
you'd be amazed.
Can we just update the name of the panel, or it's an education on alien lore?
I'd say let's roll initiative between Prop and Meg.
Let's go. speed dice.
So the reason I mentioned it is because I have never, like, I was not super into Alien prior, but getting somebody who's in their element running a game is so unbelievably different than just playing the game itself and like, I'm gonna read through the book and I'm gonna understand everything about what it provides me for lore. The guy who ran it put together, you know, four of us, and we, like, he could throw down vocabulary and just lore and things casually in the way that he narrated, in a way that you, having only seen most of one Alien movie, I was in it. And I was as immersed as I possibly could be without having that experience because of the secondhand information and like passion from the guy running it. So I think niche in general, whether it get down to really specific, like this is one topic I'm really good at or not, is important just for the sake of, if you're playing what you love, it's inherently going to be better.
Absolutely. I agree with that 100%. Yeah.
I will say, in response to my stress, I can say that I don't like stress mechanics, but only because the ones I've experienced so far have not actually added anything to what should be a tense and emotional and kind of rough, like, emotional experience. Because I, like, a stress mechanic in itself puts these weird, like, external, outside of the game kind of, like,
would you say pulls you out of the moment?
I was about to get to that point. Yeah, is that I think my niche might be just staying deeply in character and not having to worry about the rules. Not because they don't have to exist, but that if the rules are there, they're just there to push the narrative in a fun new direction, as opposed to like the stress table was like, if you rolled stress, like you get some like randomly rolled like problem, and like that what didn't connect for me. So I would have rather it, like, I would prefer a stress mechanic that is less mechanical and more like heavily improv based. If it's all about staying in character and dealing with situations as they arise, I'm cool with that, because I would love a game that's like really like fast paced and things are constantly happening and you are running to get escape, and like that kind of like thriller aspect isn't bad in a TTRPG. I don't want to say clunky, because a lot of people like mechanics, but like the kind of mechanics that like pull you out of character are just not for me.
Sarah, how did you, because you got slammed with a lot of it when we played, how did Raven's Crest line up? And I'm getting somewhere with this, but like, how did the stress feel for you there, and how it was tackled?
Right. So I feel like I'm, again, Proper and I are very similar in our approaches to the games. Like, I love those like shit, is my character gonna make it kind of moments, as long as it's like narratively important. Like, I feel, well, that's not even true. It's I want it to feel like it's a part of the story that it's happening, not necessarily like being like brutalized by mechanics. I've played at tables where it's just like you're just getting smacked down with like negative effects. Here's this thing. This person's doing this much damage. And it's just like a barrage of numbers and status effects. Mm-hmm. And like, that's not necessarily like I don't thrive in that space. However, with Raven's Crest, like I would say that I did enjoy it because it was like there were narrative things happening, and it was loose enough and open enough that I could like actually like to Proper's point, be the character responding to the events, right? Mm-hmm. And it, not only that, it enabled my fellow players to be characters in the moment, right? Mm-hmm. So like when I roll a fail on my I can't remember exactly the stats, but the dex, and I fall through a rotted floor into like the floor below, there's real stress there because it's like, shit, like the way that this is designed, I'm only gonna have so many hit points, but it, or hit protection, but it's like it heightened, it elevated those narrative moments instead of like kind of making me be like, okay, well now I gotta track this thing and I gotta do this thing. Like the stress that I could experience as the character was real. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily like not real, but like motivated from me, not from something saying, okay, this is how you're gonna have to respond to this moment.
Mm-hmm. The reason I ask is because, and I appreciate the response because I'm the one that ran that, so I was not looking for a talk mm-hmm. up on the session, but I appreciate that because when I ran, or when I played an alien, my only problem with it was not the stress dice. I think the stress dice are a fantastic mechanic. The adding of extra dice in the stress moments, because you're both finer tuned and also in a place of panic, is really cool. I love the way that it worked, but the tables got really clunky out of nowhere. And I had a discussion with the GM afterwards, and I'm like, if I were to run this, there would have been four or five different moments that I would have given stress to players because the player was stressed. Because
right.
the character didn't receive it, but I watched the player like physically buckle up and be like, oh, I don't like this. I don't want to go that way. And I'm like, right there. I would have popped it in right there to use the mechanic to reinforce
what's happening.
Yeah. The mechanic should always reinforce the character thing. And I don't think Aliens is bad, but I think it's designed. I think if you do it rules as written, it's designed to be put in a place where like people who don't quite know how to navigate that yet have something to lean back on.
Yeah.
But those kind of tables and things should never be a hard, you know, yeah, a hard rule. Because I adore stress stuff, but I like, as a GM, because so much of my stuff is improv, I like watching the table and reading the room, much like a poker game, and being like, all right, I'm gonna, you know, let's throw some chips on your table and make you more stressed because this is how your character is responding, and I want to reinforce that so you continue down that road.
This is a fun way to kind of bring things up. I did post a question in Player Pub, and I appreciate everybody who responded, and big shout out to you guys. This kind of brings in the play between, because I asked this question because a lot of the people here really focus on improv, storytelling, rules light. I was trying to find somebody who leaned more into the mechanics side of things, and kind of the general consensus ended up being mechanics should feed the story, but like JK said, they're a really good way to, really good thing to fall back on. In Turk's words, it's a great starting ground for those who are maybe not as confident in their RP capabilities, maybe they're just starting out in TTRPGs in general. Having prompts, dice rolls, things like that are a way to kind of get involved and help facilitate your character and the story without being, I shouldn't say without being, but if you're not as directly involved in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, we end up in a debate all the time about mechanics versus narratives here. So
right.
Can I throw this out to the group just to So I find that when it comes to mechanics, D&D, it is all mechanics are at the core, and it's not a problem. Like Sarah, I'm sure you're very narrative focused, but I bet when it comes to D&D, mechanics are much more prominent than if you do anything else. Is that fair to say if I throw that out at the group?
Yeah, I think that's totally fair. And it's interesting too, because I feel like there's two different approaches to this question, right? Are we talking as a GM or is we talking as a player?
Oh, yeah.
And like, cause like, that's my thing. Like, there's like with certain like moments, like as a GM, I'm a very fluffy GM. I struggle with like consequence or like fails or whatever. It's like same. I'm a fluffy GM. Like when those mechanics like don't work for my shit, I'm like, get them out of here. Like I'm done. But as a player, like I try to lean into them. I try to like embrace them. Like my character for Harper's right now, Rory, like his whole thing is like, whatever happens, happens. Like, like whatever the role is, I'm just like, that was fate. It was meant to be. And like, maybe that's me trying to make peace with those like mechanic demons. But like, I think it just depends, right? Like, but absolutely, Dungeons and Dragons is mechanics. It's mechanics all the way down.
I'm so glad you brought up D&D, Vizual, because I was about to say something basically the same. But also, so 5e had a great like start into the world because it like had less mechanics than previous games. But I feel like a part of the success was also that like there is enough mechanics that players who are not comfortable getting deeply into role play and into like getting into character can rely on those to do pretty much anything in the world. And the same thing with GMs. If you're a new GM, you can feel free to rely on the like the crunchier mechanics instead of trying to flavor your world in other shit. But as JK has learned recently, that like just reworking D&D isn't gonna get you everything. So
out me like that.
You've said it publicly. You're fine.
No, I know.
Basically, what I'm trying to get to is that like there is a lot. There is a certain amount of mechanics you can lean on for sure, and you can play the like almost board game style of D&D. But I think that what we've come to realize over the last year or so is that like, what if we just don't? What if we only rely on like your deep understanding of your character or deep understanding of other players at the table? And like, that helps a lot. And playing in a consistent group like TPK really helps that. But I forget where I was going with this, but basically is that there's like enough here for young players who don't understand the like acting side of things to connect with the game.
For me, it's the only game that I play where I'm reaching for the rule book.
Raise your hand. Most, how many of us started
or Google? Like Google, I'm going, okay, what's that? Like, it is really most of it's spells. Like a lot of it is like spells and things like that. But yeah, it's interesting that. But again, I don't mind it. I'm probably more like everyone, whereas I'm kind of like, I like the idea of mechanics until they get in the way, and then I just toss them out
the window.
End up using them. I'll come up with a great mechanic, and then I just don't end up using it.
Yeah.
But that's not the case for D&D. And I don't mind it, I guess. I'm just saying I'm comfortable
D&D,
with it.
Because, I 100% agree. I think I when it comes to D&D, I'm more mechanical focused than I am with any other system. And I think personally I discovered that I have a hard time just chopping off the head of mechanics that I don't like in D&D, because there feels like there's so many that they kind of web together if you get rid of the wrong one.
Right. Yeah.
And Proper had mentioned that, you know, I have made comments about you can't just hack D&D, and that's really what got me into like the top shelf and the 90 something different tabletops on my back wall here. That it's when we're talking about mechanics should only be present to supplement and improve the story. You know, they should serve to benefit the character and the GM and the story overall at the table. A lot of the times it is easier to find a system that is the story that you want to tell. I did an interview with the Iron and Lies author, Bats, actually, and we talked about
it. I love that system.
It's phenomenal, and it's a perfect example of, like, you don't need any rules. Rules are designed to be supplemental in the event that you need them or you need to lean on them. But we talked about my wall and evidently his wall specifically as the fact that now I play, before I used to play games with D&D, like, you know, whatever story we wanted to tell, we'd fit it into here and we could recolor it. You know, and we just kind of exist in that make-believe space. Now I treat game night like going to a Blockbuster, where we walk to the wall and we say, what story do you want to tell? What are you feeling today? And we find a game that reinforces that story, and then we play that. Because it's easier to get into, it's easier to vibe with mechanically, and you typically don't have to worry about any kind of recolor. So any rules that you need to drop are only at the discretion of, like, yeah, it's unnecessary right now because we're having a good time. But beyond that, like, it's already set the stage for whatever the table wants to do, and it's a lot easier than trying to navigate around rules that want to be all-encompassing that there's too much of.
Yeah, I hear you, but I want to pull it back a little bit too, because like when we're talking, because I mean, we're talking about niches, right? Like, what do we individually, like, bring? And I feel like that is system agnostic, and I'm going to kick it back to Fazul here, because, like, I've played Iron and Lies, Altered Carbon, the one page system, and I feel like I'm missing one. Like, I've played multiple systems.
Plan, something's wrong with the rats.
So I played multiple systems with you, and regardless of system, like, it didn't really matter. I mean, like, there's always, like, I feel like, as a both as a player and as a GM, like, there are things that you uniquely bring to that, like, whether it's embracing mechanics to, like, push narrative and push the twists, or even if it's just, like, hacking the game and, like, I'm buying a bad table for myself as the GM right now because I want to, like, push this thing. Like, I think that's inherently Fazul.
That's true. And it's funny when the whole mechanics thing has brought me back. When I first started writing, one of the first things I wrote down is, I'm not writing anything with mechanics. I didn't want mechanics. I created one-shot RPG to use in my things because I just kept getting emails from people going, why are there no rules? Where's the mechanics? So I was kind of forced into it, but you're right. It really doesn't matter for me. You can give me any mechanic and I'll sit down at the game and it's going to run the exact, I'll just change it to fit.
It's a Fazul game. It's the shape and the way you interact with the world might be different, but it's a Fazul game. And I feel like that's something in TTRPG communities that I have found. Like, there are certain, like Nick, you already kind of said it, like, there are just certain tables or certain places where I feel like I thrive and, like, where I find the thing that I'm passionate about. And it could be like Altered Carbon is crunchy as fuck. Like, there are so many rules there. Like, there's just layer upon layer of mechanics. And, like, I gotta be honest, like, that's not my jam. However, I thrive there. I love the heck out of that game. Like, I'm looking forward to it, like, every time. And I think it's because I'm sitting at a table where a person is, like, in their element, thriving in their niche of, like, twists and stuff.
If I had approached that game with, I'm going to follow the rules as they are, it would have failed within.
I'm out.
It would have been
I'm out.
I would have been out too, because I would have been like, oh my God, I'm driving myself. Not. Yeah, believe it or not, I cut about half of the rules out, right? So so it's interesting. It is. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's funny. That was actually great for you to say, because it's a, it gives me, actually caused a reflective moment in my head on myself. So that's awesome. Thank you.
Let me kind of ask y'all this, because we've been doing a lot of back and forth and you guys are knocking out all the questions that I had listed, but I'm going to backtrack a little bit.
We say, fuck the rules and fuck your order.
Fuck the rules. Fuck my notes. Do what we want.
No, I'm so glad. Hey, as
the mechanics of your panel have
Like, I'm half tempted to, like, go, like, you can't see it on screen. Like, I'll just pop away and grab my stack of notebooks that I have. I'm a huge fan of notes. Let's go.
Sorry, you were saying, Meg.
Chrissy.
I just had to put that joke in.
Chrissy, fantastic job, because you're kind of bringing up what I'm going to feed into. We're doing a lot of back and forth and talking about each other's, what we think about when we look at each other. What's kind of going through your guys' heads, one, when you were thinking about what your own niche was and how you identified it versus how you're looking at somebody else and identifying theirs? So, like, Sarah, what are you thinking when you're talking about Fazul's or JK's? What are you right. guys thinking?
It's interesting because I feel like when I was first playing TTRPGs, I started out in home games, right? Like, I'm playing with my group of my friends and getting, like, either enjoying it or having just not a good time. And I couldn't really explain why. And then I started playing with TPK with, like, a broader group of people and, like, had the exposure and perspective of, like, different tables, right? And, like, straight up, I've played at tables where I had a just garbo time, did not enjoy myself. And it was like, why is that? And the more I played, the more it was like, oh, here are the things that I enjoy, right? And then what I realized is, like, there are things that I enjoy about TTRPGs. I have my niche, and I was able to discover it by watching other people in theirs. Like, it's kind of like, which comes first, the chicken or the egg? Like, it's sitting down with different groups and, like, watching how they play and how I responded. Like, one of Saint is a GM for me, and he's a player. He GMs for me, I GM for him. And, like, sitting down at his table was just like, this is it. Like, this is the shit. Like, this is the stuff that I'm here to do, because it's like, it's pushing the characters to, like, role play. You're, like, deep inside, like, a lore and a world. I'm like, and this is what it is. But it was me finding my niche because he was in his. And so, like, being able to watch other people, I would say, is how I found mine. But a part of that was finding what was not mine. And, like, I think that's why the more people I play with, like, everyone here I've played with, and everyone here, I'm like, yes, I'm going to, like, there's proper, you and I, we vibe with that, like, staying in character shit. Mads, yeah, let's do full Chaos Lord, like, whatever, like, who fucking cares? Let's just do whatever the fuck, you know, like. And then, Chaos, like, Fazul, it's like, I don't know what's gonna happen next, but, like, I'm ready for that ground to just fall out from beneath my feet. Like, there's pieces that connect everything, but I wouldn't have known that unless I'd played with you.
Yeah, it's funny, Sarah, because, and I had mentioned this on Discord at the group beforehand, but there are niches that develop organically, and I would say prior to streaming and writing, they would have been all organic. And it's just, what do I like? What really driven by what do I like and what do I don't like? And I don't know if it was conscious. It's just driven by your emotion, right? Essentially, you just gravitate towards things that you like. Since streaming, however, and writing, so there are things where I sat down and I deliberately went, I need to develop a niche. What is that niche going to be? And I think, but it can't be disingenuous. So I can't take a niche and go, oh, this is a great niche, I'm going to take that on as a part of my persona. But if it's not genuine, it's going to fail. It's not going to work, right? So for example, the niche that I mentioned earlier, which is twists, that was not organic. That was very deliberate. You know, I literally sat down and I said, I want to be the twist person. But the genuine part of it was because I love them. Like, as an audience member, like M. Night Shyamalan, I was one of his, you know, biggest fans. There's like, if I think about all the things that I love, twists were at the center of it. And so for me, it was deliberate, but also genuine at the same time.
Mm-hmm. That's really cool.
No,
please go ahead.
I think that's a good point to think about what things make you excited about other people's art. If you're watching a movie, if you're watching a play, if you're reading a book, what are the the books and the movies and the TV shows that get you excited and why. I think when it comes to how to find your niche, it's just playing in a lot of different games, a lot of different people. That helps for sure. But the other part of how I got to where I think, I don't know how to explain my niche, but I know kind of what it is. And Sarah, you said it as well, is that it's, again, something that I love, but it's, I grew up and went to school for doing theater. And so that is my brain is, I can't separate that from my brain. That is how my brain functions.
That's who I am, right?
Is it a theater world sense? Yeah.
I can't think of proper without thinking about him yelling at me in group DMs, lean into the bit.
Sorry, Meg, I apologize for that. But
it's all that yes and improv with you, and I appreciate it.
Chrissy said it earlier, was just, it's improv and yes and, which is something that like I'll never stop harping on. But I think to mention Saint one more time, we'll just all talk about Saint, how we love Saint. But
absolutely.
Basically, there was a moment in one of the most recent episodes, the one just before this last one, and
at Roundhouse,
mm-hmm. Omega. There was an episode where I got separated from the group, and so I was alone in the call with Saint, and that I think is where I found my niche, is because I found a point where I wasn't playing, like I was fully enveloped in my character and just back and forth with the DM in their character, just talking. And I, above and beyond, prefer learning everything through roleplay and through dialogue as opposed to any other way.
Roll an investigation check.
Fuck that, yeah. But I was going somewhere with this, but basically, like, I think the way I found my niche is I thought, okay, what are the, like, experiences that I've grown up through that is, like, how my brain works? And so because I'm a theater person, I stick to, like, stay in character, follow the story, stick to the bit?
Lean into the bit.
Like, if you know you're in a mystery TTRPG, lean into that side of it. You know you're going to have to investigate some things. You know you're going to have to talk to some people. If you're in a horror, understand that you in character are going to, like, have to, like, start hyperventilating and, like,
genre awareness.
It's genre awareness. And so I think that's how I found my niche, was being like, hey, I like being in character because I like acting, and so all my experiences and all my education comes from improv and theater.
No, I feel like I'm kind of seconding all three of you in different regards. One, in that I think finding your niche is all a big jazz. Like, if you're improving jazz, which I guess is the best analogy because I played it for years and years, as brass for big band, is you ingest as much material either from other people or other sheet music as you possibly can. You find, you know, you just listen to jazz constantly. So then you can take the little bits that you like, and then you start working them into its own forward structure. And it feels more natural because you kind of get the rhythms and the flow of things easier. And that is 100% the same with tabletops. They are so varied mechanically and narratively, genre-wise, all of that. The more that you can play, the more that you can experience, whether that be with other people or other mechanical systems or other genres, you will naturally gravitate towards certain ones. And sometimes you don't know what those are, and this is one of the greatest failings to me of D&D being as big as it is sometimes you miss out on that. If D&D turns out that it's not your niche, that is not the only thing out there, but that is a lot of the time what's marketed. So I really appreciate TPK kind of being more than that as a streaming group. But I came from, I guess, not college level theater major, like proper, but I came from a lot of theater too. Thank you, Proper. I appreciated that. No, but I came from a lot of theater as well, and like speech and improv competitions and things. And then the movie that I worked on for years prior to finding TPK, which is the thing that filled the void in my creative outlets, kind of already had me in a pretty lengthy mindset for horror. And it did not connect that that was something that I could translate into tabletops, because at that time I was only D&D. And then like we hit the 14 days of Halloween last year, and that was my first drop into it, and something clicked with episode one of Raven's like Welcome to the Booth House. That was the, I don't know, like you feel it. It's something that you can't when quite you describe. Find,
oh, 110%. Absolutely. Like it's you sit at a table where it's happening and it's like a different experience. Absolutely. It's like, oh shit, I have found my tribe. Like this is what I want to do, and this is only what I want to do. Like it's like a weird, it just seamless experience. 100%.
And it is incredible. And I urge anybody who has not found that moment yet to take the time to actively search for it. And I was thinking about this while all three of you were chatting of like, well, what do you do if you're not part of a streaming server, you know, a streaming group? What do you do if it's just you and your friends at the table? Play more than just your campaign. And that sounds harsh, I guess, in some regards, because like some people are really, really attached to a 2-year long campaign that's been going on every week. But like, find your moments to step away from it. I have, yeah, I'm running on 2.5 myself.
I've got a home game that's been going for 5 years this year.
That's amazing. That's amazing. So cool.
Oh, how?
Yeah, I mean, that there's a lot of.
All right, let
there.
Me sum it up for you. Everything is canon.
I love that.
Literally everything is canon, and it's chaos.
That's amazing.
We're going to be going into a Resident Evil Village arc.
we interrupted JK, and I do apologize.
Oh, you're good.
I can't do chaos. Not really.
No, time out. I'm a challenge that. I'm a come. Like, I play games with you. Like 100%, you do chaos. You just like knowing that the chaos is coming. Like you like having a heads up so you can get into the character of chaos. Like it's funny because like it. Like when we were prepping for Roundhouse, right? Like.
I knew you were going to bring this up.
Yeah, because I think this is how we're different in our niches. Really, yeah, like, so there was a lot of, like, cloak and dagger. You're not really going to know shit until, like, the session started. And, like, you're an improv guy. Like, you're a yes and, like, throw it at me. But at the same time, you were like, I need to know these details so I can, like, do the thing. And then I was there being like, yeah, we'll find out when we find out. Which was just kind of, which is funny because I feel like that's the antithesis of both of us, right? Like I'm the pages of notes for prepping, and I'm the write down all the detail person, and you're the like improv guy. But like, it's just in there certain moments where it's different than that, right? And like, I just want to echo what Mad said too, like play more games, like play more games. Cause that's how you find the place where you thrive and you do the thing. But like, and that's challenging if you're dealing with like home games and shit. But like, I think that's how, like, again, watching Proper like prep for like Monster of the Week. It's like, this is how we're different. This is how we're the same.
This is finding that niche. This is funny that you mentioned this because yes, like if I'm building a character, a character is like incredibly important to me, and I struggle a lot with just being able to be like, here's my character, we'll figure it out as we go along, because like I really care about like the story they're coming from, like what happened before this point. I can improv after that, but I want to know what happened before so I can like come in prepared, which is an actory thing to say now that I've said it out loud.
No, totally get it.
But also like, but as I said, like I can, once I'm there, I can like do whatever. I don't have to like pre-plan a lot.
I feel like if you definitively, you could probably see it in Altered Carbon, you can see it in most of the things, you can find the moment where I find my character like on stream. Like, I kind of show up and I go, I don't know what I'm doing. And then some weird detail will happen. Then I'm like, oh, shit, there they are. And it's like, double down and run with it. Like, I don't know who they are until I'm like at the table playing with the people. Like, that's
actually ask this because I don't know if I'm taking control of the stream from Meg, but I really want to know. We talked a bit about the games we like playing in, but like as a player, what are character niches that you fall into as well?
That's kind of falling into what
I found mine.
That's kind of falling into what HP brought up, and that's going to end up being our wrap-up question because we're coming up on our mark. Are there any particular archetypes or tropes that you lean into when creating a character? Something that you kind of revert back to?
I feel like recently, like trying to play in multiple places and trying to find my niche or whatever, I try to not fall into the same things. Like, I'm trying to like make a diverse cast of characters, but I typically fall right. Like, ultimately it's Sarah. Like, ultimately all roads lead back to like Sarah is here and present. Like, it's like, I feel like the tropes I lean into are kind of like the bookish, like, what the fuck's going on here? Like, that's whatever character I play, there's always an element of like, what the fuck is going on here? And like that sleuthy kind of like, I want to figure out how this is fucking working kind of a deal.
Genuinely, sorry, I just
go for it
directly to you, like to the or and to the table. Is that a bad thing? And I ask that in a way that says, I am kind of the same way. If I'm playing a player, there is a good number of aspects of myself that I know and I'm familiar with that I will run with, and kind of all of my characters as a player end up within this kind of thin band of color around my overall talent skill set. And I know people who get really irate at tables, not maybe directly or like, you know, confront people on it, but about people kind of, I know a guy who only plays paladins in 5e. That is the only class he will ever play. And it's not because any of the other ones are bad. He just loves playing paladins. And I think it's funny and I riff on it constantly, but like, that's exactly the conversation here, is it's like, you can play yourself. If you're good at playing yourself, you should do that. And I see a lot of conversations about the contrary, that you should build something grander or adjacent to yourself to branch out. And I don't think you should have to as a player. And maybe that's just my experience with games, but that's definitely where I see the conversation, is it's like, do I self-insert or do I build something wildly different? And I don't think either one's a wrong answer.
100%. Continue.
Go ahead. Finish up.
I wanted to kind of take it back to like, it's fun, like finding your character, because I think it's all like fits together. Like JK mentioned that, like sitting at a table and having like the aha moment. Like for me, it was the first time I streamed on TPK. It was the Harpers, GM'd by like Luca, who also is just like a GM that I freaking vibe with, man. But I sat down and there was like the cast of players. Like, it was just like a totally transcendent experience. And then I was able to bring the character that I had, and I had that safe moment of being able, like, I don't know who this character is. And then having the moment be like, this is who my character is going to be. I'm going to lean into this like quirky bookish trope. Right. And everyone at the table went, yes. And we're just going to support you in that. And I was like, whoa, like I sat down at a table of strangers that I had no idea. And they all just looked at what I was doing and said, yes, I like that. I'm going to keep going with it. And it was like, holy shit. And it was like the tropes and like all of the things, is because everyone was leaning in their own and we all recognized it and saw it in each other. And it was like, I want to do this all the time. Insert it directly into my veins.
I'm going to say this just real quick before anybody else responds, but that is a super good point, in that it is very difficult to find your niche if you're not at a table that's supportive. If you recognize somebody connecting with something that they are really vibing with, reinforce that. Whether you're a GM or a player, that's just good advice to have a good time at a table. Everybody's niche is what brings that passion to the game. let them run with it. And a lot of the times I will actually back up as a GM and be a little bit more free once I see that, because immediately you can tell people are having a better time, even if it didn't immediately vibe with my plan. Like, that kind of support is so important.
Absolutely. Yeah. For me, it's funny. Here's my observation. I'll try to get my hands in the thing. As a GM, this is my world. As a player, it suddenly I become very narrow in what I will do and what I will play, which is just interesting. And that's just me. And I don't play that often. Also, I'm going to go, this is a campaign and this is a one shot. That's my exact, but when it comes from a player perspective, not from a JM perspective, because in a one shot, if I know, listen, this is just tonight, I'm more willing to be more willing to explore with a character, to try something different, because I know I'm not going to be stuck with it for if it doesn't work for, like, you know, 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I said recently that I only ever play dumb gay boys and moms and dads. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I've ever said something more accurate, because that is all that I play. I think the closest I've gotten to something outside of my wheelhouse is actually a home game character named Imogen, who is still like trying to, like, still a smart, invested, and sort of mom character, but like also doesn't believe in the supernatural, and so like has this kind of sort of sassy attitude, but like it's not quite my original. But like, those are my two go-tos. I go to those even if I'm trying to be edgy. I come back to being a dad character. That's all Herman was. It was just me being like, oh, I guess I'm a dad again, whoops.
So proper, and my experience with you, so on the Clowns of Funland, that you didn't play that type of character.
Yeah,
no, you totally didn't. It was awesome. I loved that character.
But I don't. I feel like that's the thing, is that the ones that like slip through those cracks are a little harder for me to like define. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I talked a lot about how like having the deep backstory character is important to me, and so that's where those characters come from, is like what makes sense in the rest of the story, because I think that's far more interesting and important to me than anything else, really.
I want to connect something that you're saying and something that Fazul is saying, because like, I think the difference too is like, are we talking one shots or are we talking campaigns? Because I play, if we're doing a one shot, let chaos reign. Like, I'm going to just lean into like whatever trope, and I'm going to go so fucking hard. Like, whether it's a lunch lady, or literally playing my cat, or like, you know what I mean? Like, it's whatever it is, I'm going to do it dialed up, like rats, something's wrong with the rats. I just went full like Instagram influencer Alexis from Schitt's Creek, like hard on that. But if it's a campaign, I feel like there's a lot more subtlety. Like, I have to kind of like build up or give more space. Like, it's harder to come in with a super duper strong character. And it's funny, Valix is bringing it up in the chat, until the one shot becomes a campaign. I came in with a hardcore, strong, dialed to 12 character of Harrison, where it's basic Merlin from Sword in the Stone goes to the Bahamas and what happens to him, right? So I'm this fucking wizard who's on vacay mode and is like, fuck the man and my job. And then it was really challenging to like take that and go into a campaign, because it's like, shit, like I went for the hijinks and now I'm having to dial back. And I think the format of what you're doing super matters, right? Like, whether it's, you know, as Fazul put it, this wide lens or this super narrow one. Like, Iron and Lies, like bringing that character to a campaign, I think I would really struggle. Like, I could do it, but it would be like trying to figure out, like, I would struggle there. Like, it would take multiple sessions for me to find my niche with that character. A one shot, hell yeah, because it's a one and done. Like, I can just do this crazy thing and there are no consequences. But if there are consequences, I all of a sudden become much more reserved in like my gameplay and much more like protective of the thing, instead of just like, I don't fucking care. Yeah, I'm a lunch lady and I'm gonna just say some dumb shit. Like, it just depends.
Oh, and recognizing, I mean, just real quick, are we hitting time, Meg?
We've got a little bit.
Okay.
We can go for
nearly an hour.
Yeah, we can go we can go to maybe 10:30, I would say, our latest.
Cool.
Got to go a little bit before then because I do have work, but
that's important.
There we go.
But no, I was going to say, to your exact point, Sarah, this actually falls back into the same conversation about like thematic GMing and things. And I think that like running a campaign in high fantasy is a lot easier than running a horror game. I had great difficulty between sessions of trying to figure out what to do for Ravenscrest when that was present, trying to figure out how to make sure that everything is still narratively functional, but we're getting intense horror each time. And the only thing that I could think of was to make sure that those are broken up chronologically, so it doesn't feel like shit's just going bad for days and days and days, because that's not, you know, there's no break in tension. So I find myself when I'm running games, because I understand like my niche is very much let chaos reign. I'm going to improv. We're going to play horror. We're going to do something that's not going to be as nuanced as like the super cool stuff that Sarah does for the Bard's Refrain, like being as lasting as it is and the way that it's moved. Mind you, those are wild episodes. So like, They're all fantastic.
You wanna play Dungeons and Dragons for 9 hours straight? You come talk to me.
Ooh. Not inaccurate, seeing the recent Bards of Frains.
I've run a 23-hour session before, so they get wild.
That like it's a brag, and I'm just here like.
It was over the course of 2 days. It was over the course of 2 days, and we did eat and sleep and have like breaks. But no, the point of that, sorry, was like I find myself liking limited series and liking one shots because of the niche that I find myself in. I would rather reinforce the structure of what I know I'm good at than try to lengthen that out. Much like, you know, you find a character niche or you find a like as a GM, I want as colorful and varied NPCs as I possibly can. But as a player, I'm a lot more grounded and I kind of fall into a singular ribbon. When it comes to running games, I know what I like. And depending on what I'm playing, the stronger I am at that particular genre and story, typically those tend to run into one shots so that I can reinforce and let people just do whatever the hell is going on. Because that's the place that I thrive, so I know that I'm going to be able to give the players the best time. So I don't run anything beyond like this one home game campaign that I've been running anymore. Because I like the function of one shots. And I think it's interesting because I know some people don't as much. And that's another whole conversation about like, you know, how you build a character for a one shot versus a campaign. Are you more comfortable running them? Is its own conversation. I'm very long-winded. I apologize.
You're good. You're good. We're trying to wrap up. Like, what is the final questions?
We haven't heard from Fazul yet about the characters, yes. I think.
Oh, shit.
Niche characters?
Yes, something that you
I just talked about that. I find it narrow, but to be honest, I don't... I'll tell you one of the things that which is just to myself... has been eye-opening is with TPK is that like I listen to a session and someone's like, I'm a Warforged or I'm a Tabaxi or I'm a Luxodon, like Tyron is playing, and there's a part of my brain that goes, what? Like, what are you playing? Like, it's like, it would never cross my mind. Like when I'm when I open the D&D book, human, elf, nothing else exists, right? And I fall back on paladin, like you say, I fall back on classic, kind of classic hero fighter types. So that's the old me. The new me is trying to. I mean, that's why one of the reasons why I kind of went down this rabbit hole of one shots, because I recognized that that was something that players probably happens all the time. That I need to fall back on my paladin. So I'm trying to, you know, so I myself was trying to open my world to be like, okay, tonight I'm just going to do something a little bit different. Right?
There's no consequences. So you can go fucking hard.
Yeah. So, So it's anyway, it's really cool. I was telling Tyrant the other day that it's like as soon as he said he was a Lexodon, I said him a note. I was like, I've never in my gaming career ever had anyone play a Lexodon. I say that is amazing. How did you even, you know, how did you even arrive at that? Right.
I'm gonna say with mine, I typically end up playing three different types of characters. One's usually an angry brawler, one's usually an empathetic character, and one's usually that person that is geared towards being able to ask questions and find out what's going on. But most of the time, to start off, and this is where I'm going to be the inverse of you guys, because I thrive more in long-term campaigns than in one-shots, because all of my characters start off very reserved and kind of closed off as, one, I get used to the table and the story, and the character gets used to things going on. I think the exception has been a couple of times in games that Mads has run where we had Vicky get really loud and cuss a lot in the Mothership game, and Davis for the Resident Evil game, who've been kind of my outliers.
I think you say that that's opposite of what we've been saying, but like I feel like you just did exactly what Sarah said. Like, the one shots don't matter. You can do your I'm not reserved characters,
see,
from the get go.
There are a number of one shots where I've still played the reserved characters, like Dungeon Bitches. I was really reserved, and even in the first one with Mads when we did Morkborg, was really reserved. So it's, yes, I'm branching out and learning a little bit more, because as I'm getting used to, one, being in TPK, to streaming and exploring different things, but that's still something that I know I have a tendency to fall back on.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah. No, I totally agree with you, Meg, because it's like, again, like, as I don't, most of the time, like, I don't write backstories for characters anymore. Like, and it's like, I just kind of show up and I'm like, let's figure out who this is as we go. And like, it's, with the like campaigns, like with that reserved, you can be more intentional and take your time and really like figure out who this person is. But in a one shot, if you like sit down and like with that approach, it can be very different. Like it's again, like it's just, it just totally is dependent on, you know, what it is, the things that you prioritize. And one of the things I really appreciate about your playstyle, in the rare occasion that we've gotten to play together, is how intentional you are with like that reserved nature. You know what I mean? Like that you really hold back and like make pointed choices about like, and this is when I'm going to do the thing with this character. And like, I've not had the opportunity to play long term with you, but even in the one shots that we've played in, I can see that part of you where it's like, I'm going to hold and hold, okay, and now we're figuring this out a little bit here. And I would love to see how that played out long term.
Maybe one day I'll be in a long-term game. We've seen a little bit with Singularity and the Henshin game, but maybe we'll see more with God Kings, because I'm doing a little bit different with that one too. So
yeah, exactly what Heck just said.
When you have the chance, explore, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're all saying. Yeah. Is just keep playing more, play different games.
Just
play more games.
Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to experiment. Don't be afraid to reflect and ask people for feedback is the big thing that I guess we're trying to gear towards here.
Yeah.
Because that's the only way you're going to figure out who you are as a player, a GM, and figure out what your niche is.
Yeah. And like lean in too, right? Like once you find your spot, like, just do the damn thing. Like, call it like it is. Like, can I fit music references or something into here at any point in time? I'm a fucking go. And like just embrace yourself and like find tables that embrace you too. Like, that's really what it's about, is that sense of community and continue to do the thing.
Yeah. Also, Fazul, go ahead.
No, I'm just saying that's like I think there was I think it was a form some session a while ago where they're talking about trust. But for me, if you're not at a table that you can't trust everyone there, it's really hard to do anything other than play it safe, right? So
mm-hmm.
Yep.
So that's incredibly important.
If you mm-hmm. find your niche, I bet you there are like hundreds of indie TTRPGs that actually could play really nicely into your niche. So yeah, if you do find it, reach out to friends and be like, yo, I like this. What can I do with this? And I'm sure one of us will know several answers.
Oh, yeah.
One of us here.
Hit up the Discord and there's lots of stuff that, you know, we can help out with if you ever have any questions. Like the TPK Discord is so goddamn friendly. And we want, like, the niches have been something that we kind of passively talk about all the time. Like, we want everybody to be in their element. Play in your element and reinforce others that are in their element, and you will have a better game, just mm-hmm. in general.
Exactly. Embrace that passion.
Absolutely.
So I know JK has to get out of here. Are we wrapping up now?
I think so. Is there any final questions or thoughts we or the chat have?
I'm like scrolling through chat being like, okay, you've said a lot of important things, but what's... It's a good thing that chat is very large in this overlay so people can actually see what they've been saying, because they've been saying a lot of good stuff.
You guys have been popping off and we really appreciate it.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we'll give them a minute to kind of see what they're thinking. Do you guys have any final parting words?
Hi, my name's Sarah and I have opinions. I think
guessed.
You never would have guessed.
Shocking.
I think this is an ongoing conversation. You know what I mean? I think as this closes out, or I think this is a really important question. This is a really important topic, and I make huge kudos for like bringing it up and bringing it to the table of discourse and saying we should talk about this, because I think like it's something that I enjoyed playing TTRPGs as I did. TTRPGs are fun. I didn't know the magic of TTRPGs until I found the thing about the experience that resonated with me. And Luca and I have had this conversation many times. Finding the thing that clicks for you, like getting the assignment, finding the thing that works for you is like the best feeling. And if we can help more people like find that and experience that, like that should be the end goal of any TTRPG community, I feel. So like while this conversation might end like with this panel, like with this particular group, I would hope that like the folks in chat and we continue to like help each other find that magic spot, because it's really like that's what it's about, man.
Yeah,
is that human connection, and like once you get that good like I found my place in the world, it truly like transcends, like it takes it from being a game to like being an experience, and I think that that's really special.
Yeah. Storytelling is a human experience. It's something that has always brought us together throughout hundreds and hundreds of years, like just constantly. And tabletop games are another means to facilitate that. Like, it's a way to feel connected, and I 100% agree with all of that.
It's a really great way to, like, feel that validation and feel seen, I think.
Yes.
Proper, Fazul, you guys got anything for us?
Well, I'm trying to wait. I'm waiting for my comments if we're going to say, like, goodbyes and everything at the very end or not, but...
No, I just agree with what everybody said. I mean, it's funny. It is a community experience, and it's great. Like the thing that I find is that as a GM or even as a player, it's through exposure to other people that I'm growing and going down this journey. But I love, Sarah, how you said a game versus an experience, because I don't know if I had put it into words before, but that's exactly what I'm seeking. I'm seeking for an experience. And that's what separates a great game from a, you know.
You started writing stories instead of games. You want the stories. You don't.
Well, you're right. You're right. And that's why at the very beginning I avoided mechanics, because I went, I just want to write the story.
That's what I'm saying, is that you wrote just right. stories.
Yeah, absolutely. Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. That's what it is. At the core, this is all about storytelling. And I think mm-hmm. that's the thing. When you get to storytelling, suddenly it isn't a game. I mean, otherwise yeah. you're just doing the, like, I don't know, I think I almost threw, I think, I remember when one of the D&D issues was introduced and one of my players said, I do a half movement. I almost threw the book at them. Like, movement, what is that?
How's
that?
Right.
What's that? Yeah. Story, but yeah. Mm-hmm. That's it for me.
Okay. So if we're all good to wrap up, let's go ahead and do our outros. We'll go ahead and start the same way we did with our introductions. Proper.
Hi, my name is Proper. I'm a TPK staff member, role player, game designer, etc. I want to say, if you enjoy my weird improv heavy, just story based storytelling, I did write a game that's specifically about this. It's called Generational, a story about stories. It's on itch. It's very fun because you roll a single die pretty much. So it's flexible. And the whole point of the game is you only tell stories. You don't do anything else. And so I'm working on its sequel now. But if you want to check me out, you can find me as Proper Nerdy on itch. Oh, good. Purplefield just linked, or both Sir Heck and Purple just linked to the game in chat. So check it out. It's very fun. I play a lot. I'll be in a lot of things this weekend. Look at someone type TPK Con in the chat and look at the schedule, because it'll be great. Sarah, you're next.
Hi, I'm Osarix Franco. You can find me on Twitch and Twitter at Osarix Franco if you like my face and the things I say sometimes. You can find me here on TPK Roleplay in a variety of games as players. The Harpers, Dark Echoes, Roundhouse, Omega, which its last episode is Monday, and Atrium of Aquarius. You can also find me over at Nat20. And Against the Tides and Morningstar and Company. And then I also GM here, the Bard's Refrain, which is our next session is a week from Saturday, where you can watch me put like what I, these words, you can see it in action there and watch me be the fluffiest one. I just want to tell the story with my friends. But again, I just, huge thanks to Meg for inviting me to this panel, and a huge thanks to, you know, Fazul, Mads, and Proper for having this conversation. And again, I encourage chat, like, check out the Discord. Let's keep talking about this, because finding community in a place where we all belong is really important, and it's something that we can help each other with. And like, let's do the thing where we make tables where everybody finds their niche. Kicking it over to Matt.
I appreciate that. Thank you. Yeah, I have been I almost just autopiloted right into, and I've been your host. I'm not this time. I am a player conversation person this time. I am Mads. You can find me on Twitter, Discord, those sorts of things, at JK Madigan. Mostly check out the Twitter, and then you can get to everywhere else from there. But the conversation's been great. I love I don't know, there's something about just sitting down and talking to people in TPK that I just love. Like, everybody here I adore for everything that they bring and who y'all are as people, whether that be Meg or Fazul or Sarah or Proper. And thank you, Sarah, for keeping me on track earlier today. I'm starting to diverge, so before the coffee had kicked in, so thank you. But I love the conversation. I will be present tomorrow at 6 p.m. Mountain Standard. I guess that would be, what is that, 5 p.m. Pacific, 8 p.m. Eastern, whatever you want to call it, to do, I can't believe it's not game design, which is going to be a delight. It's also the craziest shit I've ever done. So if you want to see me potentially crash and burn, that's a good place to do so. But it'll be one of those two things. It'll either be absolutely fucking amazing, or it'll go off the rails, and I have no idea which one, and I'm so excited for it, but come watch. Fazul, all you.
Awesome. Going back to my First of all, thanks, Meg, and thanks to the panel. Going back to my previous analogy, prior to joining TPK, my world was like, for our gaming was like this, and now it's gone out. It's been really cool. I've been lucky to have the same gaming group for like 20 years, I think.
That's amazing.
But again, it's amazing to get to play and see and watch how other people approach this. As for me, a week from Monday, we're back with the next episode of Atrium of Aquarius, our Altered Carbon campaign, where Morrigan, played by Osara X Franco, gets to find out why are there two of you. That'll be a very interesting reveal. Also, I am a game designer, writer. You can find mostly one-shot stuff on DriveThruRPG. And it is actually, the brand is One-Shot RPG. So if you type that in, you can find all kinds of interesting, mostly horror stuff, also a fair bit of D&D. But other than that, maybe I'll see some of you in a week's time.
Okay, and I have been your host, Meg Mysteria. I'm going to continue this, thanks. Thank you, everybody, for joining me here on this panel, Proper, Fazul, Mad, Sarah. And thank you, chat, for coming in, asking us all these questions, and hanging out. You can find me at Meg Mysteria on Twitter, on my personal streaming channel. I'm going back and forth between Resident Evil and Alien Isolation right now. Yes, I'm continuing my branding.
Love it. Here for it.
But as far as what's going on, we've got a lot of great panels going on this weekend, so stick around for more discussions, one-shots, and we've got Battle Royales coming up. As for what's coming up next, at 11:30 EST, we've got Reach for the Stars, which is a Violet Core one-shot being run by the great Sir Heckalot, you know. So, stick around for that, and if we don't have anything else, we will see you guys, I will see you guys again anyway, in about an hour. Alright.
Take care, everybody.
Bye, guys.
Adios.